Hello again, everyone, and welcome back to Bloodborne the Old Hunters. You'll be noticing about now that I've gone and visited a Yharnam barber for a haircut. This one was on special, it was very deeply discounted, and I thought I would take advantage of the absolute rock-bottom price, but as it happens, I'm not sure I'm quite happy with it. As a matter of fact, I'm actually really regretting it, to be honest. Of course, in reality, this is really just beast mode, and I wanted to take really the entire episode to demonstrate it. This is going to be a much more elaborate demonstration than any of the other weapons I've shown up to now, unless you count the boss fights in the previous episode, and even then, this is going to be quite a bit more elaborate. I'll be using this setup for the entire episode, and I wanted to show right off the bat that what actually causes the transformation and what reverts it is equipping and removing the Beast's Embrace rune. You'll also see here that not all of the equipment you wear is actually displayed on your character model in beast form. Your hat and gloves, in particular, are not displayed, which means also that if there's a particular hat or pair of gloves you want to use as a beast, you don't have to worry about matching them to your pants or body piece, because they just won't be shown. And I also wanted to illustrate here that your role in beast mode does change, and I should clarify that in order to change it, what really the way this works is, if you have the Beast's Embrace rune and the Beast Claws equipped at the same time, the moveset of the Beast Claws will change. You'll see that it not only changes your role, but also your backstep and the entire moveset of the weapon itself, which is one of the things I appreciate. What they've essentially done here is they've turned one weapon into two completely distinct ones. I also appreciate the hair physics on the beast form itself, and I should note that while I've elected not to wear a body piece here, you can, and the body piece will still be displayed on your character as well. Take note of what the ordinary R1 chain of the standard beast claw looks like, because that's all I'm going to demonstrate here for the sake of comparison and to illustrate that, yeah, there actually is a difference. This, meanwhile, is the ordinary standard R1 moveset of the Beast Claw with the Beast's Embrace rune equipped. You can see that it's a much more bestial moveset, really. More aggressive, more vicious, and I think a lot more badass and just generally cool. I feel like they really nailed it with this, and a number of us obviously were very disappointed about the lack of beast mode in the base game, but at the very least, I think they got it right with this. You'll also note here, when I turn around and stand still, that this also changes your, idle battle stance after using an attack in transformed mode. You'll see that when I demonstrate the transformation attacks, which I think is coming up soon. Again, the downsides to post-commentary. I spent more time demonstrating the moveset just by itself than I did with most of the other weapons, because I feel like this one in particular is considerably more unique, and I felt like it deserved that much more time and attention, because obviously beast mode is kind of an integral element to the themes central to the game, and especially considering that it's something so many people, myself included, were disappointed about not being able to experience in the base game. And I mean, better late than never, I guess. At any rate, this is what I was talking about. Here's the transformed combo, the transformation moveset. And this is the idle stance that you get when you use that in transformed mode. Really, when you use any attack in transformed mode. There are a number of other differences between this moveset and regular weapons as well. These are the backstep attacks, and a lot of these attacks, the sort of utility attacks, running attacks, backstep attacks, rolling attacks, are combos. The Beast Mode Beast Claws also do not have a charged R2 attack. In lieu of that, they have a combo. This is the R1 chain, and you're about to see the R2s here. That's these. So, although they're not quite as effective as a charged attack, you can see here that they are quite nasty, and they have very significant damage modifiers. They do a lot of damage, and they hit very quickly, as well as inflict a considerable amount of super armor damage. In lieu of a charged attack, however, the beast claws in their transformed mode do have this. Well, no, actually, I guess I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. This is the dashing R2 attack, actually, and I think this is really cool as well, the dragging your claws on the ground and doing the cross slash. I believe I'm about to show here what this has instead of the charge attack. Yeah, I am. It's this. You've probably seen this move if you watched any of the trailer footage for this expansion before it hit retail. This is a really, really neat attack, and it's neat for more reasons than one. You can see here, you can actually change its direction in midair after initiating it. But probably more importantly than that, it does still function as a charged attack in that if you hit an enemy with it from behind, and that enemy can normally be staggered with a charged attack from other weapons, it will still stagger them, and you can then backstab them anyway. This roar is the L2 attack. This is a spherical AoE that does a relatively minor amount of damage, but also inflicts considerable hit stun and will cause enemies to flinch. It has another interesting property as well, which is that if you hit an enemy with it, it will build up your beast meter. I wanted to demonstrate that here, and guess who got to be my test subject? Sorry. I promise I'll make it up to you. And the advantage to that move is that if you get surrounded by a large group of enemies, particularly small enemies against which it will actually do a substantial amount of damage relative to their max HP, hitting the entire group with it at once will give you a significant boost to your beasthood meter. So there are some tactical applications for that as well, which I appreciate. For now, though, we will... I guess you'll just have a chance to see it in action as I traverse this area, but I'd like to talk a bit about the area itself. Because here is where, thematically, I feel like the game has really taken a very interesting, almost survival horror-style turn. Looking around this place, it's obviously kind of a hospital, but kind of a research center. And it's populated with these horrifically deformed patients who all seem to have grossly enlarged heads. There's also this pool of what seems to be some kind of poison in the middle. And as far as I can tell, it would appear to be used for the disposal of cadavers. There are also a number of locked doors in this area, and one of the elements that gives it a survival horror sort of feel for me are these plaques next to each door, telling you what floor you're on and what room is beyond the plaque. The area itself has echoes of the Tower of Latria to a small extent, and probably more than that, the Duke's Archives. You'll note that architecturally, it has a lot of similarities to the Duke's Archives. These staircases, for one thing, and also the balconies, the mezzanines, lining the exterior of the room. Not all of the patients are friendly, unfortunately. Most of them have more or less just gone crazy, or their condition just causes them to misperceive everything around them. There are reasons why they are in the shape that they're in, unfortunately, and I'll discuss those in a little bit of detail as I go. But what this place reminds me of probably more than anything is Alchemilla Hospital from Silent Hill 1. And obviously there are differences, but the whole atmosphere of a decrepit, unsanitary, falling apart, run-down hospital with all kinds of terrible things going on, it really gives me that sense quite strongly here. And I'm kind of surprised by that, I guess. It seemed like they were really pushing the... I want to say Lovecraftian horror elements, but they've only... And a number of you have made this comment not just in the comments of this playthrough, but also the main game Bloodborne playthrough that I did a while ago, where many of you had pointed out that the elements this game does borrow from the Lovecraft mythos really are fairly limited. They tend to focus more on the old gods theme, and Cthulhu in particular, because I think for a lot of people who have any knowledge of Lovecraft at all, that's really the extent of their knowledge, and many of you also seem to think that based on some of the comments I've received. And between that and what I think amounts to, again, a fairly narrow depiction of gothic themes and elements in this game as well, which I think again come down to the most commonly known and expected ideas of what gothic horror is, I'm quite surprised to see them take this turn with the game's aesthetic. It's not an unpleasant surprise. Actually, I quite like this. I think this is one of my favorite areas of the game so far in terms of its aesthetics and its theme. But it's sort of a surprise to me nonetheless, just because I feel like, what was their reasoning? They clearly didn't see any necessity in sticking to the same pattern they'd already established, I guess. And again, I don't mind that. I like a little bit of variety, as long as it's relevant to the story and to the overarching themes, which this certainly is. And I like also that they've really gone out of their way to make these rooms very creepy and foreboding, and we're about to see a little bit more of that as we progress.
Guilty. I know. But I won't do it again. I promise. The darkness. It frightens me. And what rises from its very depths.
So as you can see, the patients of this hospital are not very happy. Nor particularly comfortable. And I say hospital, but at this point, it's blatantly obvious that this place is anything but a facility for healing. This is actually just a research laboratory for the Healing Church. And it's such a huge secret that it actually only exists in a different dimension, in the nightmare. That's how secret this place is. That ledge over there can be reached with a jump from here. It's actually quite similar to the Berg skip in Dark Souls 1 in that regard. I tried it, I wasn't able to get it on the first couple of tries, and figured it probably wasn't worth wasting that much time on, because I'm going to be coming back that direction from the other side anyway. This guy, on the other hand, this is a much more dangerous enemy type than the smaller patients wandering around other parts of the research hall. He is completely blind, and he won't be able to detect you unless he hears you. But he will hear you if you knock over any of these bottles or transfusion stands or any other destructible items in the environment. Fortunately, I came prepared with a +10 beast claw filled with the best and nastiest blood gems available from the Chalice Dungeons. So the enemies in this area, for the most part, are going to be reasonably trivial unless I get careless and allow myself to be ganged up on. I want to point out, though, that wandering around in this dark room listening to that guy scream, especially if you don't already know what's going on here, is a pretty creepy and fairly ominous atmospheric element, which is no accident, and it's something that I really appreciate. I feel like This place had maybe a lot of care lavished upon it, and perhaps a little bit more so than some other areas of the game. And here more than anywhere else, I think, you get a sense for just what sorts of terrible things the Healing Church is doing. These patients with their bloated heads, what's going on here is essentially that the bloated head is the Healing Church's equivalent of Bergenworth's lining the brain with eyes. The bloated heads are filled with brain fluid, and the brain fluid has a connection to the ocean from which the Great One Kaz came. We're going to be finding out a little bit more about Kaz and what became of her as we proceed through the expansion. But the idea is that by filling one's head with brain fluid, this achieves more or less the same effect, although the game and the various other sources of plot and information related to the plot kind of indicate that it's a more primitive equivalent of that, and that the Healing Church was maybe not quite as successful in their research as Bergenworth was, because what the Healing Church is using to achieve that is blood, whereas what Bergenworth and Master Willem used to achieve it are just straight-up eyes. So we see here another interesting element of this environment, which, again, was not necessary, but that I really appreciate, and it's something that's kind of... You look at it and you go, what the hell is going on here? There's a wheelchair huntsman with a Gatling gun on that ledge, mowing down patients who are trying to climb the stairs. So this just serves to make it all the clearer that these people are not here for the purpose of healing, nor really for any personal benefit. And their human rights are really not being considered at all. Another dark room, and again, one of the elements of this area that I feel really add to it, and I knew about this ambush from the very beginning, but if you don't know about it, what will happen there is that's a relatively unique enemy type just to the left of the door there. There are only, I think, two of them in the entire game, and both of them are set up for ambushes like that. What'll happen is when that guy sees you, he'll run over and perform a grab attack, where he'll wrap a basically a leprous arm around your face and poison you. So this place is, I think, very effective at driving home the message that it wants to send. And we haven't even seen all the nasty stuff it has to offer yet. I wasn't able to get through the area in a single episode because, although it's not really technically all that big, as you can see, it's really windy and convoluted and loops back on itself a lot. It has that classic Miyazaki level design touch to it. And I think it does really a very good job of making the most effective use of a limited amount of space. And I think really that's one of the things I appreciate most about the Souls game and games in general. Here, though, this is another one of the things we haven't seen yet up to this point. See that little raised square of floor tiles? Yeah. So you have to watch out for that. Now, I thought I'd be a wise ass here and kill this guy in style. Sometimes I wonder why I even bother. And look at that. What an acrobat that guy is. Look at him just in his wheelchair, balancing on the railing. Like it's no big deal. I have never, ever been given such a big middle finger by a guy in a wheelchair before. Other than that one time I ran a red light and there was somebody in the crosswalk in a wheelchair. We won't talk about that. Instead, we'll talk about the fact that these guys seem to be missing something rather important. And it does not seem to be bothering them in the very least. I kind of liken this to a chicken with its head cut off, because as long as it still has its brain stem, it'll wander around. Like, It's no big deal that it's missing its head. That's a real thing, by the way. Look it up. Plague of Gripes will be happy to tell you about it. Now, this room in particular, this is something that I think, if you're not prepared for it, it'll probably really scare the hell out of you. That's supposed to be an ambush, but I guess it won't actually trigger? That enemy up there is supposed to fall down on your head and perform a dropping attack like other blob or slime type enemies in the Souls series. But I guess you have to actually activate this ambush and turn all the enemies in this room hostile first. The way this works is there are a bunch of these dead blob things on the floor, and these are actually the heads of the headless guys that are wandering around outside. Apparently, when their heads become bloated like this, to the extent that the patient is nothing else, they can just survive without the body. So, if you just wander in here and walk right by them without noticing them and grab that item over in the corner, all of the blobs in this room will turn hostile and they will block your way out, and they will spam you to death with tentacle whip attacks and blood spits that inflict frenzy. And we all know how bullshit frenzy is in this game. So it's to your advantage and fully in your best interest to kill all of the enemies in this room before you go grabbing the shinies. And boy, is this ever a shiny. I can't actually show you guys what it looks like because it won't appear on my character model with the Beast's Embrace runes set. But believe me when I say that boy, is it ever a piece of troll equipment if I have ever seen one. Bye, guys with no heads. Enjoy not having to listen to motorcycles go by, I guess. Now, another thing that I appreciate about this area in particular is the fact that in addition to all of the staircases and the various other shenanigans here, we get some other shortcuts as well. We get the elevator here. And this is one way. You can only activate this elevator from up here. There's another one in the room it connects to that you can activate from this area, which is accessible a little bit sooner. You can just walk in here right away. I just happen to take a different path here. Just because. I mean, there's no real set path you have to take through here other than just generally working your way up to the top. And again, we're going to have to get to that in the next episode because there really is a lot to explore here. More than I can fit into half an hour anyway. And here we get to see just how brutal and inhumane the Healing Church's experimental procedures are. These poor patients are not only impaled with scalpels and surgical tools, but this guy's head, or this girl's head, appears to be stuck with what looks for all the world like a speculum. And that's not normally the part of a girl where you would put a speculum, but okay, Healing Church. Whatever floats your boat, I guess. Sometimes I really wonder about the thought processes of the people that come up with the artistic influences for these games. And yeah, obviously it's mainly Miyazaki, but he collaborates with his team as well. So if you've read any of the interviews with him, you'll have some sense for that fact. He's definitely the primary visionary behind a lot of this freaky stuff, but he has help. And sometimes I wonder about some of that help. Hell, sometimes I wonder about him. But I guess that's why we all appreciate his games. Also, very embarrassing that I knew that trap was there. I knew it, and I thought I would be able to avoid it. But apparently, I came at it from the wrong direction. And I triggered it from the wrong direction and got hit. Bear in mind, though, that these traps can also damage enemies, so you can use that to your advantage. It's probably not really worth the effort in most situations here, but if you feel like just doing it for fun, you can. And speaking of fun, this next enemy type we're about to meet down here, this is pretty fun. Or funny, maybe, is more appropriate, but let's take a look. We've got one guy just kind of crawling in circles around a couple of surgical tables over there. Another, not even really very well concealed ambush. So we just ambush the ambush, get rid of the one guy. Pick up the decorative old hunter garb, which I think I might actually use the leg piece from, at least for a little while. I just wish it were a little bit lighter green so that it would match the Tomb Prospector body piece. But now that I've gotten this guy's attention, look at this. This is not a person, it's a frog. And this enemy type, for some reason, has a disproportionately larger amount of health than almost all of the other generic patient-type enemies in here. I'm not sure why, or if it's just a coincidence, but they do. But yeah, it's interesting to me that the variety of enemies in this area, or I should say that the different variations of each enemy type in this area, because really they're all patients, but there are about 7 or 8 different subcategories of patients, each of which behaves in a completely different way from the others. And then there are the NPCs. So that's something that stands out to me as, again, if you're going to reuse basically the same enemy model, that's a pretty good way of reusing it so that they're not all just clones of each other with a different color palette or something. From here, we can see the first section of the Hunter's Nightmare, and up above us, the buttresses of an area that is based on the Upper Cathedral Ward. We'll see that a little bit more clearly in the next episode or two. The hypest dialogue on YouTube. But yes, you might have noticed that the courtyard down below that balcony I was just standing on looks an awful lot like the Lumen Flower Gardens, where you fight the Celestial Emissary in the main game. And that's because it is. The areas in The Hunter's Nightmare are based to some extent on areas in the main game, and most of you are probably already aware of that. But there are certain spots where it's a lot more obvious than others. The very first section of The Hunter's Nightmare, where it's clearly Central Yharnam, or rather the Cathedral Ward. And I guess bits of Central Yharnam as well, because you can go as far back as Gilbert's house in The Hunter's Nightmare. But there, and probably also in the Research Hall's balcony, which again is based on the Lumen Flower Gardens, those are the spots where it's most obvious. And again, I think that's really good reuse of existing level geometry. Pat mentioned this in their LP as well, the fact that they did the same thing, more or less, in Dark Souls 1 with the Ulysseal areas. So now it's time to meet one of the NPCs in this expansion.
Is that you, Lady Maria? No. You're someone else. Please, could you do something for me? I need brain fluid. Murky, mushy brain fluid.
Now, I want to point out that the reason I'm consuming Adela's blood vial here is because this NPC, whose name is Adelin, I believe, she has a unique blood vial of her own to give you.
Please, could you do something for me? I need brain fluid.
Of course, I forgot that she will only actually begin giving them to you once you've brought her some brain fluid. And I unfortunately have not had time to obtain brain fluid before having to wrap up the episode. I will be picking up some brain fluid in the next episode to bring her, at which point we will take a look at the description of her blood vial. But until then, I would just like to thank you all for joining me as always. I look forward to seeing all of you next time. And thank you all for joining me.